Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 9507 in the name of Alistair Allen on Epilepsy Scotland report, Epilepsy on the Mind. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Alistair Allen to open the debate around 7 minutes. Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this chance to highlight to Parliament the hugely important work which Epilepsy Scotland does as an organisation, and specifically I want to mention the research and recommendations which they've recently published around the impact of epilepsy on mental health. Epilepsy, I should say, is not an uncommon condition, and yet it continues to be a very commonly misunderstood one. And those very misunderstandings often have a real impact on many people's well-being. It is perhaps therefore important to make one distinction from the outset, and that is that epilepsy itself is of course not a mental illness. Much of the stigma which has in the past been applied to epilepsy has in fact been grounded in that very equation of these two things. It is a misunderstanding which 150 years ago stepped neatly into the space then just being vacated by earlier public assumptions that had placed epilepsy firmly in the supernatural realm. Such widespread public ignorance of what epilepsy might be is complicated further by the fact that the condition takes so many widely varying forms. In any case, Epilepsy Scotland's survey has showed us that 54% of people with epilepsy felt that their condition had had a significant impact on their own mental health. One in three people reported depression and half described anxiety. A lack of awareness among the public is but one of the factors that lies behind those very concerning figures. Let me take just one of those issues, and this is one that people in urban Scotland will probably recognise less perhaps than those in rural areas. Losing your driving licence, something of course required for anyone whose symptoms are not controlled, means that the chances of finding employment, or at least employment that uses all your talents, declines very steeply. So the survey found that 61% of people described epilepsy as having had an impact on their employment. And employment, or the lack of it, is in turn a factor which drives a sense of isolation. Again, the report bears this out, with 72% of people reporting that epilepsy had affected their social life. One case study, Nicola in Orkney, had this to say. I really struggled with losing my driving licence. I lost all my independence and really had to rely on other people to take me places because we weren't really on a bus route. So it was a case of making sure I had a lift from my partner or my mum or dad, and they were really good, but I hated asking all the time. Presiding Officer, I developed epilepsy when I was 17, and I hesitate to claim that epilepsy had any direct effect on my own mental health. It's not an issue I was really aware of, possibly because in those days I do not recall mental health even being a widely understood concept. Probably, however, it was also because I was very fortunate. At its worst point, I generally had only about 8 or 9 seizures a year, far fewer than many other people. And after a process of medical guesswork, medication eventually brought my symptoms completely under control after about 15 years. When I was young, I'm not quite certain that I treated my condition with the respect that it deserved, probably due to the pretty limited information then available to me about it, and the only very occasional opportunities I ever had to meet anyone who might remedy my ignorance. My own seizures included one while I was working on a ship. Another seizure conveniently gave me just enough warning for me to jump off my bike. One was in a pub before I had even had time to order a pint. Another was during a job interview in which, I am pleased to say, I gained employment. One was during a student political meeting, during which, I understand, debate raged during the several minutes of my unconsciousness as to whether or not someone should raise my hand to vote for me, it being quite a close vote at the time. And one seizure occurred during some very misjudged hitchhiking through a war zone and resulted in me coming to in a Croatian military hospital with no ill effects. Now, I'm pleased to say that the sources of information and support for people with epilepsy in Scotland since the days of my own youth has increased dramatically in no small measure due to the work of Epilepsy Scotland, who are here in the gallery today, as well as through the work of Scotland's National Epilepsy Centre. Epilepsy Scotland have, for instance, a helpline service which includes check-in calls, where officers with counselling qualifications will call someone once a week for 10 weeks to let them talk about their worries and any issues related to their epilepsy. However, there remains a huge amount, presiding officer, still to be done, as Epilepsy Scotland's report now shows us. The report concludes with some important recommendations, and I hope that the Minister may be able to reflect on some of those in summing up, in light of the Government's commitments to step up support for mental health services more widely. Among these recommendations are the need to continue to grow the number of mental health trained professionals, including counsellors, available to people with epilepsy, and to increase the level of understanding of epilepsy amongst those working in mental health services. To increase the number of in-person support groups for people living with epilepsy and their families, for all agencies to work collaboratively to create a strategy to improve the mental health of people living with epilepsy, to increase public awareness of epilepsy to the wider public and for improved societal understanding, and to ask health boards to consider steps for routine screening of mental health issues in epilepsy clinics, with immediate referral to mental health support where required. Presiding officer, can I again conclude by taking this opportunity to commend the work of Epilepsy Scotland, a sentiment I know will be shared by the cross-party group on epilepsy in this Parliament, and in particular to draw attention to the work they have done in this report. So I just want to conclude by saying it is a report which highlights very effectively how epilepsy is a condition with very human impacts on very real people.
Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. And I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by David Torrance, around 4 minutes. Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Alistair Allen for securing this debate and also acknowledge the good work that he does as convener for cross-party group on epilepsy. I think that having this kind of conversation in the Parliament sends a clear message that we care, we're on your side, and we are committed to working with you to improve the lives of those living with epilepsy. Can I also thank Epilepsy Scotland for their work and also welcome them and some of their members to the gallery this afternoon. It is so important that we active and motivate organisations to work on behalf of groups that often can feel that they are being left behind. Presiding Officer, the report that we are discussing today sheds light on the fact that it is crucial to recognise that the disabilities faced by individuals are not the sole aspect requiring attention. Their mental health also needs equal consideration. Disabled individuals often encounter significant emotional and psychological challenges due to the stigma, isolation and limited accessibility to services. The impact of these factors on their mental well-being should never be overlooked. It's so important that we recognise and address the mental health challenges faced by individuals living with epilepsy. While epilepsy is primarily a neurological condition, it also takes a toll on a person's emotional well-being. According to the figures from the report, over 1 in 3 people with epilepsy in my region of Lothian struggle with anxiety, and the same number report that we deal with depression. These numbers are heartbreaking. Despite the growing awareness about mental health, there remains a significant gap in the support and resources available for individuals with epilepsy. To truly address their mental health needs, we must prioritise specialised mental health services tailored to the unique challenges faced by this part of our population. The report makes a number of excellent recommendations on how we can begin to close this gap in support. One such recommendation suggests implementing routine screening of mental health issues in epilepsy clinics and facilitating immediate referral to mental health support. This would be a simple yet immensely positive step for health boards across Scotland to take. This approach would ensure that mental health concerns are not left untreated or undetected, leading to improved overall well-being and better management of epilepsy. Moreover, swift referral to mental health support services would offer timely interventions, allowing individuals to receive the necessary assistance and support tailored to their specific needs. This easy and proactive measure has the potential to significantly enhance the holistic care provided to individuals with epilepsy, ultimately fostering better mental health outcomes and a higher quality of life for individuals. Presiding Officer, all of the recommendations from this report promise to make life better for those with epilepsy, and I hope we can get a commitment from the Minister tonight that in her closing, the Government will commit to rolling them out, not in a decade's time, but with urgency and within this time of this Parliament. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I now call David Torrance to be followed by Carol Mauch in around 4 minutes. Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also welcome members of Epilepsy Scotland to Gowrie tonight. I'm very grateful to Alistair Allen for securing this important debate today and providing us with the opportunity to mark the publication of Epilepsy Scotland's report, Epilepsy on the Mind. That has laid bare the impact of epilepsy on mental health, making a crucial milestone in our understanding of this complex condition. Epilepsy is one of the most common serious neurological conditions, impacting on an estimated 58,000 individuals across Scotland, each of whom is living with a very complex condition that can strike unpredictably and carry immense implications for their daily lives. In my constituency of Kirkcaldy, there are over 800 people are living with epilepsy, and an estimated 4,000 across the whole of Fife. The physical implications of epilepsy are well known. However, it is not only the physical manifestations of epilepsy that we must consider, but also the psychological impact. It is a matter of urgency that we recognise the intertwined relationship between epilepsy and mental health. The Epilepsy on the Mind report, based on a comprehensive national survey involving over 700 participants with epilepsy, reveals that 54% of the respondents reported a significant impact on their mental health due to their condition. These are not insignificant numbers, and we must not treat them as such. More, however, the report tells us that 46% of these individuals struggle with anxiety, and 1 in 3 grapple with depression. We need to acknowledge the stark reality and do more than just sympathise. We need to take meaningful action. The mental health repercussions of epilepsy are not a secondary condition, but an integral part of a condition. As influential policymakers, we deserve our full attention. As Deputy Convener of a cross-party group on epilepsy, I have had the opportunity to meet with and hear with organisations and stakeholders across Scotland about what we can do to better support those living with epilepsy, including make sure their mental health is prioritised. These groups have made invaluable recommendations to the CPG, and I know that the Scottish Government takes these recommendations very serious in their work to provide support for people throughout their experience living with the condition from the point of diagnosis and onwards. Epilepsy Scotland's recommendations that there needs to be a wider-reaching epilepsy special mental health support in Scotland is crucial. We are being called to action to extend our understanding of epilepsy beyond the seizures to comprehend how it can pervade all aspects of an individual's life. This is not simply about allocating more resources for mental health services. It's about creating a mental health service that is tailored and specific to the needs of people with epilepsy. We know that the pandemic and the cost of living crisis had a significant impact on mental health and well-being across Scotland, and it is reassuring to know that improving mental health is a priority of the Scottish Government. And I very much welcome the Scottish Government's significant boost to mental health spending, including thousands of grants provided to grassroots community organisations who provide targeted support, including to people with epilepsy. This funding, combined with the Scottish Government's investment into epilepsy, specialist diagnostic tests, treatment options and ongoing care, is creating a landscape in which mental health of people with epilepsy can be prioritised. And the Scottish Government's support to Epilepsy Consortium Scotland is also invaluable, as it raises awareness about how we can best support people with epilepsy. This brings us to another vital point in the report: the role of societal understanding, particularly amongst employers and education establishments. Epilepsy should not be a barrier to opportunities, neither should it be a cause for discrimination. We must work towards creating an inclusive society that not only accommodates but understands and empathises with the challenges faced with people with epilepsy. This means providing appropriate support in workplace and education institutions, ensuring that awareness and understanding are embedded in every aspect of our society. We must commend Epilepsy Scotland for its work in conducting this survey and creating a significant report. Their dedication and commitment to improving the lives of people with epilepsy are commendable, and we need to ensure that their findings and recommendations do not go unnoticed. The findings of this report cannot be just another statistic. They are a call to action, a call for a more comprehensive healthcare service, for greater societal understanding and for a renewed commitment from all of us to ensure that the lives of people with epilepsy in Scotland are not defined by their condition. This is an opportunity for us to reshape our approach to build a Scotland that not only recognises the impact of epilepsy on mental health, but also actively works towards providing comprehensive, personalised support for every person living with epilepsy.
Thank you, Mr Torrance. And I call Carol Mochan, around 4 minutes, Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Alistair Allen for bringing this debate to the Chamber and to Epilepsy Scotland for publishing the report and providing a briefing ahead of this evening's debate, and welcome to the gallery. It is right that we debate this matter. The publishing of this report shows the level of agreement from people living with epilepsy from across Scotland in saying that having the condition leads to detrimental impacts on mental health. Important point raised by them. Indeed, in reading some of the additional points made by those who participated in the survey, I find comments suggesting even the strongest people can still be suffering inside. That the challenges that come with epilepsy are not just faced by the individual, but indeed by the full family. And that although there is recognition that epilepsy is much more than a seizure, the constant fear of having seizures can be very challenging for individuals and for their families. The 85% of people feeling epilepsy impacts their mental health in a small or significant way should be a concern for us all, as we've said across the Chamber. And I do hope and I'm confident the Minister does recognise the seriousness of this and will look to improve specific areas that the Scottish Government can work on to address this. Presiding Officers, we heard one in three people with epilepsy say they have depression, almost half have anxiety and a quarter have both. Each figure in this case represents an individual with a family, with a life, with a debilitating nature of the condition. It highlights more clearly to us that these figures are quite stark and they do cause individuals and their families to suffer, and it is around that sort of mental health and wellbeing aspect. At this juncture, it would be remiss of me to not remind the Chamber that there has been calls and indeed commitments made to increase mental health spending to 10% of the NHS budget. And we do accept that there are budgetary pressures, but it has been made evident for some time that the crisis in mental health and wellbeing will be the next significant challenge to face our population. And clearly those impacts are already being felt across the country, but it's been highlighted, especially amongst groups of people with particular conditions, epilepsy being one. Not meeting these targets would be a major failing on the part of this government. The request to reprioritise funding allocation is well intentioned, but I think it is also urgent. I would ask the Minister to make that point. Presiding Officer, I note with interest the very apt and reasonable recommendations set out in Epilepsy Scotland's report, and everybody I think has mentioned that all of these things are very, very reasonable. The calls, as we have heard, include asking government to increase the numbers of mental health trained professionals, including counsellors, available to people living with epilepsy, and to increase the level of understanding of epilepsy amongst those working in mental health services, to increase the number of in-person support groups for people living with epilepsy and their families across Scotland, and to see collaborative working between mental health and epilepsy charities to develop key policies in this area. These asks are timely and, in my view, reasonable, and I do hope the remarks will be reflected in the Minister's comments, and I'm sure they will be. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I'm pleased that we have been able to have this debate in the Chamber this evening. Much of the data arising from the report is concerning and it is critical, and as my colleague David Torrance mentioned, it is important that we have an opportunity to discuss these. People living with epilepsy have spoken. They've spoken loudly and clearly based on their lived experience, and it is our responsibility as legislators to take that seriously, bring it to the Parliament and ask the Government to act. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. I now invite Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to be asked to close today's debate. I would like to extend my thanks to all members who have spoken for their very thoughtful contributions, to Alistair Allen for raising this important issue and sharing his personal experiences. I'd also like to welcome members of the public to the gallery, as well as representatives from Epilepsy Scotland, and I'd also like to note the important work that the cross-party group does. The findings of Epilepsy Scotland's Epilepsy on the Mind report are stark. The report, along with the constituents' experiences and stories members have shared in the debate today, really emphasise the impact that epilepsy has on the mental health of those who live with it, and as Carol Mochan rightly commented upon, on their wider families as well. It is sobering to hear that one in three respondents to Epilepsy Scotland's survey has depression. I was particularly struck by the fact that 62% of respondents thought that having epilepsy had impacted their employment prospects, and I recognise the example that Dr. Allen gave regarding somebody losing a driving licence in a more rural constituency, and I will reflect on that. Tackling the disability employment gap is an integral part of our vision for Scotland to be a leading fair work nation by 2025, where fair work drives success, well-being and prosperity for individuals, businesses, organisations and society. Improving the employment prospects of those with epilepsy is very much part of that approach, and Epilepsy Scotland's report shows us why this is very much needed. As others have said, an estimated 58,000 people in Scotland are living with epilepsy, making it one of Scotland's most common neurological conditions. Alistair Allen's motion acknowledges that the condition affects people across Scotland, including in his own constituency of the Western Isles. These facts, when considered alongside Epilepsy Scotland's striking statistics about the impact of epilepsy on mental health of those living with the condition, starkly illustrate just how much work there is to be done and how urgent and important that work is, as Jeremy Balfour highlighted in his contribution. The actions recommended by Epilepsy Scotland and Epilepsy on the Mind are well thought through, and I agree with Carol Mochan, reasonable, and can improve the lives of people with epilepsy. They give myself and officials and the third sector much to think about, which I commit to do. I am pleased we are already taking action to improve the lives of people in Scotland with epilepsy and other neurological conditions. We are doing this by delivering the improvements in the neurological care and support framework for Action 2020 to 2025. The aims include improving the provision of coordinated health and social care and support, developing sustainable workforce models, and ensuring high standards of person-centred care for those with neurological conditions. And we are investing £4.5 million over the course of the framework to achieve this vision. Since October 2020, we have invested nearly £325,000 in projects which improve the health and well-being of people with epilepsy in Scotland. These projects include establishing an epilepsy register in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Lanarkshire and Tayside, with the ambition to scale up nationally to drive up standards of care. Another crucial element is a programme developed by Quarriers to improve the capacity of people with complex epilepsy to self-manage their condition and increase their resilience and confidence. I know members will need no reminder of the challenges faced by projects across government and the third sector that have been posed by the pandemic and the cost of living crisis, but despite this, we are making substantial progress. The projects we have funded in the first 2.5 years of the neurological framework have made a significant contribution to improving services for people in Scotland with neurological conditions. We have made particular progress on our commitments to improve patient and carer information, better integration of services and care pathways, and practical tools for workforce capacity planning. With the right commitment, as our NHS continues to recover, I believe our progress in these areas will bring about lasting changes to neurological services across Scotland, making care better for everyone with a neurological condition. In the latter 2.5 years of the framework, we now need to consolidate and build on these new approaches. We need to build networks to facilitate improvement locally and regionally and remain receptive to local need, and while ensuring that we have a consistent national picture of how services are performing. I'd like to take this opportunity to put on record my thanks to Epilepsy Scotland for the valuable work they do in supporting people in Scotland living with epilepsy. They and other third sector organisations continue to work tirelessly to support people with neurological conditions despite unprecedented challenges and uncertainty. Third sector organisations are a vital part of the healthcare landscape, and it was my privilege recently to meet with the Neurological Alliance of Scotland and hear firsthand from member charities about the issues facing their organisations and the people they support. Attendees advocated for people with many different neurological conditions, but there was a clear unanimity on themes like the need for people living with neurological conditions to have access to better integrated and person-centred care, concerns about waiting times, and the need for a pathway and service development. I was hugely impressed by the breadth of experience in that virtual room, the clear passion and sense of vocation for improving the lives of people with neurological conditions, and also, really importantly, the willingness to collaborate across the third sector and with the Scottish Government to achieve lasting and a meaningful change. The Scottish Government will, in that vein, work collaboratively with Epilepsy Scotland and other third sector organisations to support them through the difficult times and ensure they are on a strong and sustainable footing to continue to carry out their work that benefits so many people for the years to come. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would once again like to commend Epilepsy Scotland for producing Epilepsy on the Mind. I recommend that all members read the report and absorb its findings, and I commit that the Scottish Government will continue to listen to the experiences and human stories of those with epilepsy. We will continue working with people with lived experience, third sector partners such as Epilepsy Scotland, and clinicians to achieve real and lasting changes that improve the lives of people in Scotland with epilepsy. And as David Torrance said, to make Scotland an inclusive society. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.